First, I want to say that, you know, I just on a personal level, I feel humbled to be a participant in this discussion with some of the best people that I know. Carmen, Martha, Liz, Patrick, Claire, Mark, and of course, Steve, who is behind bars right now, and all of us should hold up Steve for doing this tough time because of his principles. And, you know, maybe there are some people who have joined this discussion today that have no familiarity with the Plowshares movement or with the Catholic Worker. You know, there was a recent piece making the rounds online about Catholic activism, and there's a lot of debate about, you know, where is there a Catholic left? You're looking at people who have spent their entire lives rooted in a firm belief in what is called voluntary poverty, who live their lives among the poor, the destitute, the forgotten, the people that are now being disproportionately impacted by this pandemic and the response or lack of response from the state and the institutions in this country, but not people who are just about charity. They're not just working at soup kitchens or homeless shelters. In fact, they are people who believe that to truly walk the walk in this life with all of the dark forces at play, all of the war and the poverty, it's not enough to just live among the poor and the destitute and the forgotten, and enough to dedicate parts of your life to walking with those who are forgotten by society and providing food and shelter, clothing, but to ask and confront a system that makes it so. Why? Why do we have a right to do anything on this earth except fight against those who want to take from the earth and to place others in positions of war or poverty or being targets of naturally occurring crises that are made infinitely worse by those in power? You know, there's a lot of talk about this election, and I think it's a stunning, devastating commentary that the best that the institutional elite of the Democratic Party could come up with as a response to this authoritarian, this reckless grifter who has sought to use the presidency for his personal benefit while threatening the annihilation of the world from his Twitter account, that the best that the party could come up with, that Barack Obama personally lobbied in secret behind the scenes to make the candidate, is Joe Biden. A man whose entire career has been marked by legislating racism onto the books, by presiding over the smearing of Anita Hill and facilitating the confirmation of a dangerous Clarence Thomas to be a Supreme Court justice. A man who has seldom met a war he didn't enthusiastically support. A man who voted for the most disastrous and criminal war that the U.S. has waged in the post-9/11 era. That is the response to Donald Trump. A man who has 24 allegations of sexual harassment, misconduct, assault, and rape. The answer to him is to run a man who has 8 women accusing him of misconduct and 1 woman accusing him of rape. We need to be able to talk honestly about what this institutional Democratic Party stands for, but also the best it offered in this campaign cycle. Bernie Sanders supported sanctions against Iraq throughout the 1990s, supported the so-called no-fly zone bombings, was extremely hawkish in the 78-day bombing of Yugoslavia in 1999. That is the best that this party has to offer, and it still has very little to say about actual war. Yes, Sanders talked a good game, but we need to be honest here that the system in this country, the best it's capable of putting out is someone like Bernie Sanders. And yet Sanders, throughout his career, time and time again, sided with the warmongers when it mattered. Yeah, he stood up against the Iraq War, but he didn't stand with Barbara Lee when she stood up against the Forever War. I bring this up not to bash Bernie Sanders. I bring it up because the strength of the witness and the action of the people who are on this call, the people that went on to that military base to nonviolently seek to disarm the most dangerous weapon systems humanity has ever produced, is because what does resistance look like in the era of Trump? It's not defined by Congress people fighting for scraps off the corporate table. It's defined by people who understand that all of these pieces of legislation, whatever scraps Nancy and Chuck get out of them, it doesn't mean a thing if we don't exist. We are at a greater threat of nuclear war now under this presidency than we have been at any point in my lifetime. And what do we see that passes as resistance? Democrats who support record-breaking bloated military budgets. Democrats who give a man they call the most dangerous president in history sweeping surveillance powers. What does it say? What does it say that even with Trump, who is grifting out in open, who is assassinating foreign military commanders on the soil of third countries and threatening nuclear war on his Twitter feed, what does it say that Nancy Pelosi and the Democratic leadership vote to give him record military and surveillance powers? It says they don't believe their own rhetoric. It says that to them, this is all a game. To the folks who went and disarmed the Trident system, symbolically, and also stopped business as usual, even for a moment, that these are the people who see clearly the threat that we face today. And the final thing I'll say is that, you know, Carmen mentioned earlier that the virus doesn't discriminate, and I think that's true. We see now it's even coming from within the homes and workplaces of the president, the vice president, Jared and Ivanka's inner circle. But our failed state discriminates. And that's why you're seeing some states reporting 70% of the COVID deaths being African Americans. If indigenous communities in this country were treated as one nation or one state, they would have the third highest rate of COVID infections in this country. This is a failed state that we are living through right now, and no amount of tinkering with it is going to solve any of these problems. And, you know, I look at my own failures in life as someone who believes in justice, and I reflect on the way that Carmen and Martha and Liz and Claire and Patrick and Mark and Steve Kelly, how they've chosen to live their lives. And I can't imagine a more just path than the one that they have chosen. And I am inspired by their courage, but more than anything, by the clarity of vision that all of them have proven throughout their lives to understand what is important to make of your life while you're here walking this earth, and what is important, when it is important to draw a line in the sand and say no resoundingly. And so I thank all of them for knowing when to say no, when to walk the walk, and when the moment for action has arrived.